This video will show you how to integrate 3D objects from Rhino into Photoshop and how to do basic adjustments with the picture at the end. The first thing we will do are some basic adjustments with the pictures. I just select from our layer manager this little lock. I can click on this lock. And with this, you can unfix the layer. I just undo it with Ctrl Z. You can also double click with older versions on the layer, and you can name it, for example, like layer background, for example. This does the same. And I just want to work a little bit on the quality of the picture. And what I always do is just go into picture correction, into German word Tonwertkorrektur, tone value correction, and I can just see that in this black area there is not really information, so I can just move it to the right, and I just move this one to the left, and this is better because it's a more crisp picture, so I can adjust it a little bit, somewhere like this. And if I just open my protocol, I just want to go back again, and I'll just show you another option, because the way I did it, I couldn't change it anymore once I did it. What you can also do, you can do it directly on the layer as a layer correction, and I just go into this pull-down menu. I go again into tone value correction. It's like this. I can do exactly the same, somewhere like this, and probably make it a little bit brighter. And the difference here is that this is something I can go back again. I can switch it on, I can switch it off, I can also click on the symbol, double click on the symbol, and I'm back in my correction, in my tone value correction. And this is really good because you have full control also after some hours, because you can always come back to this layer. You can obviously do this with many other things, with black and white, with color correction, gradient curve, and all these kind of things. What I want to do is I just want to open another picture, and this is a picture, a painting of Gerhard Richter. I just copy it, string A, string C, and integrate it into my perspective, somewhere like this. And you can see what happens. I can just pull this under my Tonwertkorrektur. And you can see that everything underneath has an impact on the correction above. So if it's underneath, it's a part of it. If it's not underneath, then it's not a part of this. It's quite handy, and I just put this back into my bin. Okay, let's create a new layer. I just go into this menu and just say new layer. You can't see this on your on your screencast, and I just call this vanishing points. Okay, this is what we want to work on. We want to work on vanishing points. I go into filters and I select vanishing points. And this is a really cool tool for designers and architects. I zoom out a little bit on this little minus so I can see the full pictures, and I can draw perspective surfaces. I just look at the tiles of my my wall and just click here, and I just go down again. This is not really straight, I can see this, but it doesn't matter. Once I did it, I can adjust it a little bit, and you should keep an eye on that the whole thing turns out blue. I just have to play with this a little bit so it fits and turns blue. Of course, if it's blue, then it just catched the picture at the background. I do it again. I just go and follow these tiles, and somewhere like this, and click here, and I click here, and you can also expand this somewhere like this, and I just draw my next surface. I click on this wall, I click on this surface, and on this one, and here on this corner. It turns red again, and I have to adjust a little bit. Now it fits, and I just take the other surface, for example, like this one, if I go down, let me see if I can see any tile. That's not really precise, but I'm absolutely fine with this. Once I did this, I can also take the point again and expand it, and you can just see that this was not really good. This point has to go out a little bit, I think. So let's try it again. I think that's more or less fine. What you can also do, you can hold your, just select this again, you can hold your string key, your control key, and just move it out, and you can also see that this works. It's not always working, it works really well right now, but there is no guarantee for this. Okay, very cool. I just close my surface, my menu, and you can't see anything in my perspective. What you have to do is you just have to tell your tool that it should produce the vanishing points also in your picture. But what I want to do is I just open the picture, this picture of Gerhard Richter. I just copy it, string C, and I just go again into my vanishing points. And there are two things I want to show you. First, what I can do is I can just string V, put it into my object, into my picture, and you can see what is happening. When you move it, it just moves from one picture to the other. And if it was connected and you saw that these two I connected, I pull it out from the other side, then you can just see that that it just goes around the corner. I also could have done it here, but probably you remember that these were not connected. And I can also scale this. I just go into transform, and here I can transform my picture. I probably hold my my shift key, and so I just transform it and equally, and I can see now it fits really well. And if I take the picture again, you can just see that it goes, it just goes around the corner. Make it a little bit bigger. Okay, somewhere like this, it's getting bigger, and here it goes around the corner. If you want to see your perspective lines in Photoshop, then you have to open this pull-down menu, and you can just have to say you want to raster this in Photoshop, and just say engine raster in Photoshop on. I just click on OK, and then you can see that you can see your grid in Photoshop. And there's one little issue: you could also see the picture, which is which I didn't want, because now it's on one layer. That's not a really good idea. So I just delete this layer, or I can also go probably in my protocol and just say I just go back one step, and now I go again into my filter and go on vanishing points. I just go into filter, and this there you can see my vanishing points again. I just open the pull-down menu. I just want to say I want to have this grid, and I click on OK, and here we go. You can see that there is a grid, and if you just create a new layer, and then you just call this picture, then you go again into copying string A, string C, your picture, and you just go into filter, vanishing points, and you can copy again your picture inside your vanishing point menu, somewhere like this. And again, if you move it, here we go, there's your picture. And I just shortcut a little bit, I just scaled it again, and that it fits, and you can see it just goes around the corner. What you can do is you can hold your Alt key, and if you hold your Alt key and move the picture, then you can see that you can produce several pictures in perspective. I close my window because this picture thing is not really important. I just also switch off the layer. What I want to do, I just want to integrate or import this picture into Rhino, if you think that the grid is not strong enough, your vanishing points, if you can just duplicate the grid several times, and then you can just see that it's a little bit better in terms of the contrast to the background. And I just save this picture, I just save this picture as a background picture. And I'll just call it JPEG background. This goes obviously background as a JPEG. And what you should be aware of, you should be aware of the size of the picture. The size is 3872 by 2592. It's a little bit difficult to remember, so I optimize a little bit. I just say it's 3800 by 2544. I just save this again, and I will just save it as JPEG. Same perspective, and I think that's fine. And I will open this now in Rhino. Okay, this is my Rhino file, and this object should be integrated into my Photoshop picture. And a very few things we have to adjust. First, I would recommend to say at the beginning, show save frame in active window on. I go into camera, and in wallpaper under file name, I can load my background picture with the vanishing points. It's called Zentralperspektive Lines. And did I select my picture? Okay, the wallpaper is there, but I still have to adjust it in rendering. If I go into rendering, then I have to switch on wallpaper. Here we go. And I think this already looks good. And regarding the size, I would just go into custom, and I would integrate 3800 by 2544, so that this also fits, and that you can just see in my save view frame the picture properly. And ground plane with the reflection, I just switch off. Rhino is not really a great tool for perspective match like other programs like 3D Studio, so we want to do very little in Rhino and just do the rest again in Photoshop. I just have one perspective, and for the perspective I just want to show the camera so I can adjust the camera. And I just go into show, and here is my camera, and I just see the perspective of my background picture. I can also recognize a little bit the vanishing lines, and I just put my target point onto the camera, onto the object. I just move my camera around. My object is close to 0, 0, 0. Also front view, it's completely close to the origin. So what I can do, I can adjust my camera a little bit. I need a feeling, this is not in dimensions now, also regarding the background picture. I just can set the position of the camera, and I just go back a little bit. I would like to change the lens. I have a rough idea what kind of lens I took in my rendering. So if I have my camera selected, then I just go into my properties, and obviously I have to select my perspective window. And then you can also see that this is named perspective, and I just give it a lens of 24, because I think this was my lens which I actually used. This looks already better. And if you double click, you can already see that it's more or less fits to the vanishing points. And I just want to have my target point a little bit higher. Not my target point, my eye view level. And somehow like this, now the object is smaller. I'm not really sure. I play with this a little bit. I'm not completely convinced. If it's like this, the object is probably 1.50 meters high. Okay, that's okay. I move this a little bit, and I don't do much. Want to move this, I switch on my gumball, and so I can move this a little bit better, somehow like this. And I also want to copy my object, and I did it with string Z, string Z. I just copy and just move it to the back, and I want to have it behind the banister. And I can also turn it somewhere like this. I can see that it's not behind because it's technically not possible. And this is good enough. I can work with the materials, I can work with the light. It definitely makes absolutely sense if you adjust the lighting situation. I don't want to do this now. It's too much work, and I think you probably know how this works. And the next thing I just will we will just want to do a visualization. If I do a visualization, it's important for me to have a transparent background. First, I will do use rendered, not ray trace, because in ray trace, this is a subdivision object, it does not work, but a ray trace is absolutely fine. If you go into capture, capture to file, then it still doesn't look good. If you go into transparent background, it's still not a really transparent background. You can see still see the pictures, so this is not what I want. So I go back into my rendering menu, and I just switch on transparent background. And what I also do, I just go back into properties again, click on my perspective, and here again I should say show wallpaper off, and this already looks quite good. Gray, I'm not really sure what this is about, but I think this is already fine. I'm not really sure about my show save frame in active window. I'm not really sure if this is part of my visualization, so I just go into capture, capture to file. This looks really good. We want to have a transparent background, so we just switch this off. This looks perfect. And we just do our visualization somewhere like this into my folder, and I save it as a PNG and just call it render02, because I already did a rendering before. Here we go, and I just go into Photoshop and open my rendering. And here you can see a little bit of an issue. You can see the lines, my show save frame window. So I don't want this, and I'll just switch this off in the next step. Okay, show save frame is off. I go again into my capture to file. I entered my 3800 by 2544. This looks all good. I think that's fine. And I call it 3 as PNG. And I just go again into my Photoshop, and I just open this. And now I don't have my lines anymore, and that's actually quite good. I just copy everything, and I'm a little bit surprised about the size. The size is 3800 by 2544. That's the same size. It looks a little bit different in terms of position. I just see what is happening. If I just go into copy and just say copy V, then it doesn't fit at the right spot. I just go back, string Z, and I just say copy in special at original position. And this already looks better, but it's not perfect. But I'm fine with this. I just call this layer objects. I double click on this and call this objects, somewhere like this. And I show you another really cool tool in new Photoshop. And you can see it under Edit and Perspective Deformation or Transformation, I don't know. I just opened this, and what you can do is really cool. You can just click on your object and you can see the grid, and I can adjust the grid to my object somewhere like this. And I just create another grid and I just connect it to the points, and it immediately snaps to the elements, and it just recognizes this as an perspective object somewhere like this. And I create another grid and connect this with this. Looks really good. And what you can do is, once you did the layout, you can just say transform, and you can transform the whole object. And you can see that I can adjust it to my perspective. There's a limit of what you can do, but I think it's already quite convincing that you have an influence on your perspective, and you look at the vanishing points, and I think this can still go a little bit lower, and some are like this. This is already quite good. And if you like it like this, then you just finish your transformation. And you can also, or you also saw that this one was also transforming, so it would have been good to put this on a different layer. I just say okay, somewhere like this, and I just take this object, I just cut this string X, gone. I just create a new layer. I just say this is object 2. And again, I just say put it into original position, somewhere like this. And now you can move this. And of course, you can also transform this. I'm fine with this. I just want don't want to put too much energy into this. But what I would like to do, I don't like that this should be behind and it's not, it's still in front of my object. By the way, you can also scale a little bit. If you go into edit transform, you can just say scale, and I just hold my shift key and I can make it a little bit smaller, somewhere like this. And now it's a little bit smaller. And I just go into my background. I switch off my vanishing points. By the way, these are now too many. I only want to have one layer. I can select all three layers. These are all three layers, and I can just say layer, reduce on the selected layers on one layer, somewhere like this. And you can see it's only one layer. It's also not so crisp anymore. I just go into my background layer. I just switch off my, well, I keep my vanishing layer point layer on. I just go into my background layer. And what I do is I just zoom in a little bit. I go into window navigation and I can zoom in somewhere like this, and I have my layer active, my background layer active, and I just cut my objects somewhere like this. This is my banister like object, and I just cut it. You can do it much better. There are much better ways of how to cut this off. What I, by the way, like, I like if you have a little bit of soft edge, as I say, radius 1. And what I do, I just say string copy, and I just create a new layer, and I just call it front. That's not really nice now, but that's fine. I just put my layer to the top, and I go again into copy and to original position, And now my object is behind, and with the navigator, I just move out a little bit, and this is already quite good. I just switch off my grid. I don't need it right now anymore. And I look again at my picture at the background. It was object number two. It's like this one. I select my layer, and I think it's a little bit too bright. I just go into correction pictures and just say. Many options to work with. Actually, I can go and use a tone rect correction and just see if I make it a little bit darker. I'm not really convinced about this. I go into a correction and just say Farbton Sättigung. I take a little bit of saturation out of it, somewhat like this, and adjust it. Already looks a little bit better. So there are many options. I can also change the color, by the way, completely. Which was not my aim, but doesn't matter. Now I did it. Okay, and same with the picture at the font. You can do everything again. It's probably a little bit situation can be a little bit lower somehow like this, and many options to adjust, and also obviously the color. What I want to show you last is that there are some reflections on the floor. I just give you a quick idea of what you can do with shadow, and it's just a really rough way of how to do this. There are definitely better ways, but I will just show it to you right now. Okay, I just take the layer of object 2 and I just pull it down to my duplicate area, somewhere like this, and I call this shadow. And I just pull shadow underneath my object, and I go into my transform area and just say transform, and I want to distort this, and I just move it down the top like this, and I'm not really sure, to be honest. If I like this, you can also, by the way, mirror it, but I think that's fine. And this is the difficult part because it's really reflecting. I'll show you what I normally do with shadows like this. I just copy it so we have two variations. Okay, what I normally do, I just take, make it completely dark, somewhere like this. I take out the color. For example, like black and white. Do I have the white? Black and white, maximum black. This didn't have a big impact on it. Okay, what I do is I just go into correction and reduce the brightness. So, am I on the white layer? Let me have a look. This looks good. I think it's my screen. It's already quite. Dark again. I just go into brightness. It's a little bit darker, but it doesn't do much. So what I do, and for this it's not the best solution. I really like this Gaussian Weichzeichner, and you can make it a little bit. Can smooth this a little bit. It's absolutely not convincing, I know, but you can change the saturation of your layer, and somehow like this already looks much better. If I would add layers, and I just go back again, if I just add another layer and I just say, for example, this layer has more of this blur, somewhere like this, and I take the other layer, and with this layer, for example, I can just say I just cut off a little bit, a Really rough, by the way. Somewhere like this. Not nice, I know. I just deselect it. I just go again into filter. And I just say Gaussian Weichzeichner and just reduce a little bit. Then you can see that I go into a direction where it starts to look okay. What does not work is it's too black. There is not a black thing like this. And I also use reduce a little bit of saturation. And still like this, I think it was a mistake to go for such a black color. But nevertheless, it's one example. And I just go into my other shell, it's this one. And when you think about the Rhino file, it is a reflection, and so you can still see the object. And there are very few things I still would like to show you at the end of the video. And this is about that you can fade the thing away. There's something like a nice tool, it's called Gradient. It's just under the bucket. You just click this little triangle and then you can come to the gradient tool. It's somewhere like this. And normally it's a gradient between background and the font color. And this is my layer I want to work with, and if I just go into my gradient, something that this is happening, it's definitely not what I want. I just go back again, and what you have to do is you just have to create a mask. I just select my layer shadow again, and here's this little mask tool. You just enter the mask level, somewhere like this. You can already see that this changed from red to white to black to white, and I just go again into this gradient, and I click underneath my object, and I just draw and hold my just hold my left mouse click and just draw a line somewhere like this, and now you can see a gradient. This is red, but if I just leave my masking level somewhere like this, I click on this again, then you can see that there's a selection. If I now click on my delete key, then you can see that I deleted the gradient, and the gradient was not strong enough. So I just go back into my protocol, and I just say go back to the starting point. I go again into my mask, and I do it much less, somewhere like this. You can also hold your shift key, then it's a straight line, somewhere like this. And I just leave again. By the way, I'm on the wrong layer. I have to be on the white layer. The white layer is shadow. If I now click my delete key, then you can see it was too much. Sorry, I just do it again. And just select my mask and just have my shadow selected. And I just draw this line a little bit longer, somewhere like this. And click on delete. And this is already much better. When I see these kind of things, then I have the feeling it should have been even longer. Okay, I played with this a little bit more. I'm not completely convinced, but you can take a lot of time on this. I can also change a little bit the saturation of this or the transparency of this layer, somewhere like this. I just remember that I have something black on top, like this other shadow layer, and just switch this on. This is definitely too much, but a little bit of something dark underneath, sorry, it's the wrong layer. A little bit of something dark underneath, I think, is a good idea. And somewhere like this, I think it's fine, not perfect, but it already looks quite realistic. This is what it looks like without the object, that's the shadow. With the object, I still think that I have a look at this tone level correction, and I can just see that I can optimize this a little bit. And I would obviously do the same thing with the other object. I don't want to do this now because it takes a little bit of time, and thanks for watching.